Mentor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Hardboiled by Josi Avari. Narrated by Angie Hickman. Chapter 1. Handsome or not, he was a stranger. Saffron Skye saw him standing on the beach, looking entirely out of place in a loose-fitting suit, black wingtips, and a fedora. His face looked as if it had been hewn from oak. A strong jaw, angular cheekbones, and narrow temples. He was crouched down, letting Saffron's rooster Curry peck at something in his hand. But between glances down at the chicken, the man was clearly staring at Saffron's house. Saffron's house, a blue bungalow with a wide lanai wrapped all the way around it, was charming. But it held no interest next to what was behind the stranger. A golden beach and the wide sweep of the turquoise Pacific. In her 6 months here in Hawaii, Saffron had seen hundreds of people wandering up and down her beach, and few of them even glanced in the direction of the house. The stranger was riveted, though. He seemed to be memorizing the place, or casing it, she supposed. But he would be surprised if he broke in. There were no expensive electronics and not much cash. All he'd find was a cottage full of chicken decor and two refrigerators full of eggs. Anything valuable, a few pieces of jewelry, some old coins, a little cash, was hidden in the walls and floors in the house's many secret compartments. Saffron had inherited this place from her uncle, and though it looked like most other vacation houses, it was a working egg farm. Named Haole Kamoa, the Happy Chicken, egg farm long before her time, it was a modest operation, with more than 100 birds, and a beautiful, spacious egg house consisting of pens with indoor and outdoor runs where the hens could wander about in the tall grass, foraging and flipping sand on themselves for their favorite activity, dirt bathing. And the three little cottages behind the farmhouse had been cleared of all the junk that had piled up over the years. She'd only kept some cozy furniture and a few pieces of decor. Saffron had recently finished cleaning them out, repainting and renovating them so she could rent them to tourists. She had two of them rented right now, one to a couple on their anniversary trip, and one to a 50-something single woman who was trying to write a novel. She spent a fair amount of time sitting on her cottage's little lanai, gazing at her laptop in deep concentration. The three cottages were painted bright colors, banana yellow, lagoon teal, and coral pink. All had white trim, and each had a little white lanai jutting from the front. They'd originally housed the few workers who her grandparents had employed on the egg farm in its heyday. The thought of the renovations brought a pang of sadness. Her boyfriend, Keahi, had helped her. They'd worked together on the project for weeks, plumbing and wiring and scouring the cottages so that she could bring in a little more money to supplement her egg income. Keahi was wonderful at fixing things, at seeing problems and addressing them, at laughing and joking, even after a long day of waiting through the years of accumulated junk. He'd made sure everything was addressed. The roofs, the electricity. The only thing Saffron had to be mindful of was a leaky bathroom sink in the banana cottage. He thought it was fixed, but had told her to keep checking on it just in case. He'd checked on it himself during the week before he left. But now, he was gone. Thousands of miles away in Boston, and Saffron's longing for his company was sharp and constant.
You ready for the rush?
The voice of Keahi's grandfather, Mano, made Saffron jump. Mano was missing his grandson, too, and he and Saffron spent a lot of time together these days. Each of them understood, without saying, the hole left in the other's life. Saffron didn't blame Keahi. He was a trained surgeon, a gifted physician by all accounts. He had fled his work at a top hospital in Boston after losing a young patient, but the hospital had long wanted him to come back, and just a few months ago, he had decided that he needed to. Saffron had tried, in the ensuing weeks, to let him go. Not just to Boston, but to let him go from her heart, from her life. But Keahi was a rare mix of humor and compassion, of strength and gentleness. His presence made any situation better, and their connection, made him impossible to forget. Instead of sending him off with a smile, as she'd wanted to, she'd ended up sobbing into his shoulder at the Daniel K. Inouye International Airport. When she'd pulled back, tears were running down his warm cheeks. Keahi's skin was exactly the color of the sand just at the edge of the wide Hawaiian beaches, where the retreating surf left curves of tawny topaz next to the brighter gold of the dry sand. She'd kissed him then, tasting salt, and let him go. She and Mano had ridden back to the little town of Maikai with a melancholy cloud hanging above them. It had taken 2 weeks and a lot of distraction to lift it. Now, though, Saffron's loneliness for Keahi was a background melody in the bustle of the day. She had an event to pull off. Her new business, Bright Blossom Events, was coordinating an annual benefit for the Friends of Hens, a nonprofit organization. Saffron's personal event planner's code was, "Be excellent, be invisible." Because she had planned this event at such a spectacular location, Saffron was sure she had achieved the first goal of the code, be excellent. The benefit was to be held on the coronation lawn at Iolani Palace. Saffron had planned for them a beautiful celebration in gold and black, two of the colors on their logo, which featured a pair of chickens like she'd seen all over the island. Wild chickens were a feature of Hawaii. Though Saffron's 120 hens and her single rooster lived in the spacious egg house with wide indoor and outdoor runs, automatic water, roosts, and nest boxes, there were as many as 20,000 chickens that roamed the island free and feral. Friends of Hens worked tirelessly to help control those numbers in a humane way by catching chickens and shipping them to their rescue farm on the mainland. They were a well-respected organization, and sympathetic donors attended the benefit in droves. During her first meeting with Friends of Hens, Saffron had revealed that she owned a chicken farm, and the passionate staff had insisted coming up from Hawaii for a tour. Once there, they found that Saffron's uncle, Bo, had assembled a varied and beautiful flock of all different colors and shapes. It was then, in the heat of their delight, that Saffron had agreed to showcase some of her birds at the event.
"The guests can see then what real cared-for chickens look like."
The director of the organization, fittingly named Bertie Bromley, had clapped her hands with delight. She was a small woman, middle-aged, with enormous round glasses and a way of cocking her head to the side that made her look very much like her namesakes. Saffron had tried to explain that her chickens were free-range birds that spent their days wandering in and out of the egg house, scratching and roosting and slurping up centipedes in the tall grass of their outdoor runs. Recently, several of her commercial egg customers, the Oceanside Cafe and the Paradise Market, for example, had been sending produce clippings and unsold fruits and vegetables out to the hens, and they'd been scratching and pecking at tomatoes and peas and lettuce, standing atop big mounds of produce. They were not, she emphasized, showbirds with proper manners for such an event. But Bertie insisted that the event could not go on without them.
"People see so many feral chickens," Bertie had pleaded, "and they think that all chickens are scrawny and unwanted, but these girls," she waved her hand down at the row of pens, "could give them another view of chickens. They could be ambassadors for their species."
She had personally selected 5 of Saffron's most beautiful birds, and Saffron had gotten the distinct feeling that if she refused, Bertie would find herself another event planner. Mano was here to help her catch them, get them ready for their 4 hours of fame, and attend the event with Saffron. Back in Washington, D.C., before she had come to the islands, Saffron had run an event planning business with 2 full-time assistants and several part-time staff. But she hadn't quite got Bright Blossom up and running to that extent yet, so she had no employees. She and Mano did everything necessary to arrange the event. Though she insisted on paying Mano, he wouldn't take cash and generally forgot to cash her checks. Saffron tore herself away from the window, even though the stranger was still standing like a stone on the beach, staring at the bungalow. Something told her she would see him again.
"You are an ambassador," Saffron hissed at the fluffy hen in her arms. "Stop flapping."
When she came to Hawaii less than a year ago, Saffron had expected beautiful flowers, beach bungalows, and the ocean. What she had not expected was a grand and elegant palace like the one she was standing in front of. Iolani Palace, in the heart of Honolulu, stood as regal as the Emerald Mountains at the island center. Luna, the chicken in Saffron's arms, didn't seem to care that they were in such a regal setting. She flailed about for two more full seconds before trilling her annoyance and settling down into Saffron's arms. Saffron tried to smile at the stern, suited attendant eyeing her and the bird. "Is this the next animal on the permit?" the man asked.
"Yes, yes, Luna."
Saffron raised the chicken a little in greeting.
"She's a lavender Orpington."
Saffron raised a hand to stroke the hen's soft feathers. They were a shade that Saffron had seen only in the early morning sky, before the oranges and yellows of sunrise. Soft, cloud-gray feathers that Luna kept preened and fluffed. She was a big chicken. A round and fluffy hen that trilled contentedly as she waddled around her pen back at Hauʻoli Kamoa. The attendant scanned the paperwork. He was a big man, bald and intimidating, with a mainland, maybe Californian, accent and a firm set to his pale jaw. Saffron could see why he was employed here. Nobody would want to break the rules with his narrow gaze on them. "The chicken will be contained at all times," he said forcefully. "You will be responsible for any damage the chicken does to the grounds of the palace. We assume no liability."
"Right,"
Saffron said, glad that Friends of Hens had signed all the paperwork for hosting the hens here at their event. She carried Luna to her appointed place. Friends of Hens had supplied beautiful chromed show pens. Saffron had set them atop chest-high pedestal tables with flowing black and gold tablecloths, depending on which color best showcased the color of the bird. Friends of Hens had offered to put soft shavings down on the bottom for the hens, but Saffron knew that the minute she set her girls on shavings, they would scratch right to the floor of the pen and toss those shavings out onto the tablecloths and any admiring onlookers. She opted for long shreds of colorful paper and coordinating shades. As Luna settled into the springy bedding, Saffron worried she may not ever be happy on anything less elegant in the future. The day was uncomfortably warm, but Luna looked at ease. Saffron worried about some of her heavier birds, and this hen was round and fluffy, a beautiful example of one of Saffron's biggest breeds. A high voice at Saffron's shoulder drew her attention.
"Oh, aren't they stunning?"
It was Birdie, rushing across the wide lawn. Behind her slouched a skinny teen in khakis and a white shirt. Birdie's hands were clasped together in ecstasy.
"This is the perfect event,"
she indicated the sweeping lawn, dotted with high tables and careful seating arrangements. Saffron was proud of it. From the scattered chickens to the delicate toasted seed cakes, it was an event fit for chicken lovers. On one table, baskets of plastic Easter eggs sat ready. Because the guests would be here to make donations, Saffron had procured an enormous blown glass jar that was roughly egg-shaped and had set out the plastic eggs as a fun way for guests to donate. They could tuck cash or checks into the eggs and fill the jar with them, providing a visual representation of how much good was being done for Hawaii's chickens. Birdie grasped Saffron's arm.
"That will hold so much money."
"That's the goal," Saffron smiled.
"And these beautiful hens will make everyone want to donate,"
Birdie sang.
"Tell me again what kinds they are so I can answer when people ask me."
Saffron started to tell her that each chicken was identified with a card on its cage, but Birdie looked up at her so imploringly that Saffron realized she just wanted to talk about chickens. So Saffron indulged her. "Luna here is a lavender Orpington. Tika, over there with the gold feathers laced with black, is a gold-laced Wyandotte. Blossom," Saffron waved a hand at a beautiful hen covered with tan, black, and white speckles, graced with a fluffy crest atop her head, "is a Swedish flower hen." Birdie made a joyous sound.
"She looks like she's wearing a crown."
Saffron appreciated that Birdie loved her chickens. "She does." They walked over to Curry's cage, and he switched from his anxious tuck-tuck-tuck sound to his contented rattle that he saved for his friends. It amazed Saffron that he remembered Birdie after only visiting Hauʻoli Kamoa once. curry here is kind of special.
Because he's the rooster, Birdie jumped in.
Well, that and his special color. See how his feathers are edged with blue? Birdie nodded. That's because he's a blue-laced Red Wyandotte.
Like Tika? Birdie asked.
Saffron was impressed that she remembered that Tika was a Wyandotte. Yes, but different coloration. And over there we have Cleo. She's the huge fluffy buff one with the black collar.
A Brahma?
Birdie was clearly pleased to know this breed. Right.
Oh, aren't they fantastic?
Birdie clapped a little, making Luna jump a little in her cage. The teen looked through Birdie to Saffron. My mom is crazy about chickens. Saffron detected the emphasis on the crazy. Saffron felt the need to defend his mom. After all, she appreciated Birdie's enthusiasm and activism in a world that was too often cynical and complacent. Chickens are fascinating creatures, she said, looking the kid in the eye. Did you know they are the closest living relatives to Tyrannosaurus Rex? The kid leveled a half-lidded gaze at Saffron. That would be fascinating, he said, if I was 4. Saffron wiped a hand across her beaded forehead to hide her surprise. She realized that she was used to the relaxed, cheerful, live-and-let-live attitude of her neighbors in Maikai. This bitter banter was jolting. But Saffron had lived most of her life in Washington, D.C. She could remember how to be sharp and cold. Oh, you aren't? She asked. I'm sorry. You were just acting so childish, I assumed you'd find that interesting. The kid pressed his lips together. Birdie jumped in.
Oh, don't mind Jake, she said brightly. He's just being a teenager.
Saffron looked to see how this assessment affected him. If it did, she couldn't tell by his closed expression. How about this chicken fact? She asked, dredging up everything she could remember from her favorite chicken handbook, The Rewarding Art of Chicken Keeping. Did you know that chickens can tell the difference between over 100 different people and animals? That's way more than dogs or horses. Curry here remembers that he's met your mom before, even though she just came by once. He looked mildly interested, so Saffron went on. And did you know that they are the most common birds on the planet? There are over 25 billion of them. I believe that, Jake said, sniffing. There are 10 billion at our house right now. Saffron couldn't help but smile. Despite his nastiness, the kid had a sense of humor that Saffron understood.
Not that many, Birdie scolded.
She gazed at a spot above her and to her right. Her tiny eyes blinked rapidly as she calculated.
6 in the crate, 15 in the coop, 7 in the shed, 3 in the bathtub.
Saffron exchanged a look with Jake, who seemed to be saying, I told you.
About 30-ish, Birdie finished. Only 30-ish.
Saffron knew chickens. She spent several days a week cleaning out big, roomy pens with 20-ish chickens in them each, and she knew what a mess they could make. Birdie lived here in Honolulu, where Saffron was sure she had much less space. She tried to smile. That's a good-sized flock.
Oh, they're not permanent.
Birdie fluttered a hand.
There are rescues. They'll be headed to the ranch out in Kentucky at the end of the week.
Saffron had seen pictures of the Friends of Hens rescue ranch. Rolling acres of green, dotted with little ponds and roosting trees, where hundreds of rescued Hawaiian chickens wandered free and happy. Funded by wealthy chicken lovers around the world who had visited Hawaii and been moved to charity by seeing the feral chickens in the street, the ranch provided the best food, the most modern buildings, and 2 veterinarians on staff full-time. The chickens in Birdie's bathtub were about to strike it rich. There will be more the day after that, Jake said. Birdie, seeming to miss the bitterness in his voice, gushed.
That's true. There are so many that need our help, so many roaming and wandering chickens, both hens and roosters, that need our care.
Jake rolled his eyes. Birdie didn't seem to notice.
Sometimes I think we should change our name to Friends of Chickens so that we could be more inclusive of roosters, but it's a lot of work to change the name when you're a nonprofit, and frankly, between the fundraising efforts and rescuing feral birds, I just don't have the time.
Saffron understood. Taking care of livestock was a lot of work, but Bertie seemed to enjoy it. Jake, on the other hand, did not. He scoffed again.
Not a fan of the feathered friends, eh, Jake? Saffron challenged.
She always found it useful to be direct, especially with young people. They were adept at spotting hypocrisy. The boy was about to answer when his gaze suddenly shifted past her, and she saw him unconsciously straighten. He mumbled a response.
Not really.
And his earlier sharp wit was noticeably lacking. Saffron swiveled her head to follow his gaze. Into the party had walked a lovely girl in her teens. She had long black hair and perfect skin that was exactly the same color as the sunlit bark of the banyan trees behind her. Saffron smiled. She'd met the girl, who worked for the caterers.
Would you like me to introduce you? Saffron asked.
Jake's eyes widened and his gaze snapped back to Saffron. There was horror in his voice when he spoke.
No.
Then with a great effort evident in his bobbing Adam's apple and his set jaw, he said,
I don't know what you're talking about.
Then to his mother, he said, I'm going to the car. I'll be back when there's food. He turned and walked stiffly across the lawn, cutting through the tables. Saffron suppressed a smile.
I'm sorry, Bertie sighed. That was rude. He's been a bit of a handful since his father left.
The words hit Saffron like a gut punch. Her own father had left when she was just a baby, and there was still a dad-shaped hole in her heart. She understood the kid a little more now.
It's okay, she said. I can just tell he likes Savannah over there.
Bertie blinked and looked around.
Oh, she said blankly.
Saffron realized that the woman really was single-minded. She had seemingly missed Jake's obvious attraction to the girl. It made Saffron wonder what else Bertie didn't know about her son.
Chapter 2.
I can't believe we're all set up so early, Bertie said, clasping her hands together.
Saffron realized that they had over 2 hours before the guests arrived, but she liked to be prepared. The caterers would arrive in an hour, and she had wanted everything set up for them. Another voice, this one much more gravelly, came from behind them.
Ladies.
Curry responded with a friendly rattle, and Saffron, surprised, turned to see the interim curator of the palace, Cyril Karsten. The usual curator, Saffron had been told, was at an important convention, and Cyril was here visiting and filling in for her as part of a job swap program. She was, apparently, doing some curating at his home museum, the Winston Pigeon Home in Flat Plains, Iowa. Saffron had no idea who Winston Pigeon was or what about his home would warrant it being made into a museum, but Cyril seemed proud of it nonetheless. He was a man whose most distinguishing feature was his broad forehead. It outshone even the pale, thin beard that covered the bottom half of his face. Prominent under a shock of nearly colorless hair and hovering over eyes the exact color of the sidewalk, Saffron often found herself watching the forehead's changing pattern of wrinkles and pinches. It was easily the most expressive forehead she had ever seen. He glanced sideways at the rooster, who was rattling contentedly, bobbing his head at Cyril and reaching up through the bars toward him.
Your chicken seems to want my attention, Cyril said, eyeing the cage as if he were grateful it was there. Is it dangerous?
Saffron rushed to assure him.
Oh, no, in fact, that's the sound he makes when he meets a friend, she smiled. He likes you, she explained.
Good.
Saffron did not fail to notice Cyril's half-step away from the cage.
My apologies, but I have just a few more papers for you to sign, Cyril said, his forehead bunching at the inconvenience. If you have a moment.
Saffron nodded.
Sure, we're all set up out here.
Cyril held out a clipboard. On it was a standard release form that allowed the palace to use images taken at the event in promotion. Saffron was beginning to feel the heat. Her hand felt clammy as she signed the form, and as she stepped back, she grasped the back of a chair for a little stability. She realized that in all the rush of getting the chickens packed up and the arrangements made, she hadn't eaten much that day. Cyril noticed.
"Please," he said. "Come inside for a moment. It's cooler. Let me get you a glass of water."
Saffron nodded. There was time, and she did need a moment out of the sun. Birdie slipped an arm through hers and steadied her as they followed Cyril to the nearest door, which led into the cool basement level of the palace. He guided Saffron to a bench, and she sat in the cool hallway as he went to get some water.
"Isn't this place amazing?" Birdie said,
waving a hand at the elegant cabinet of glassware in front of them.
"It looks incredible," Saffron said.
Birdie peered at her through her glasses.
"You have seen it, right?"
Saffron shook her head. "I haven't done the tour yet."
"Oh!"
Birdie squawked as if she'd been struck.
"Unacceptable. This is the most beautiful building on the island."
Saffron didn't argue. Cyril was approaching with her water, and she took it gratefully.
"Cyril," Birdie scolded. "Saffron hasn't seen the palace."
The forehead gathered in a cascade of ridges.
"Well, that won't do."
He patted Saffron's arm.
"When you're feeling better, I'll show you around myself."
It didn't take long in the cool, quiet corridor for Saffron to regain her strength. Cyril fetched them some blue booties to slip over their shoes, and they walked up the stairs into an impressive grand hall. If Saffron had been impressed by the palace's exterior, she was amazed by its interior. Woodwork, draperies, carpets, and furniture all made with the finest craftsmanship. There were etched glass windows, portraits, and gilded mirrors. It was like stepping into a fairy tale. Saffron had seen many state buildings, and even a castle or two, but this rivaled them all. The throne room took Saffron's breath away. She wandered over to a case containing, as Cyril explained, the crowns of Hawaiian rulers King Kalakaua and Queen Kapi'olani. The crown jewels were magnificent, crafted with gold leaves, velvet, and gems. The colors were a delight to Saffron. She had a particularly sensitive eye for color. She had learned long ago that she saw distinct shades where no one else could detect a difference. She also had perfect color memory, with a complete catalog of every new color she'd ever seen. Her ability to distinguish color allowed her to see shades of pale blue, emerald, and deep sapphire. The rich burgundy of the velvet matched, in Saffron's perfect color memory, the hue of deep red hibiscus flowers. "I didn't expect such elegance," she said as they followed Cyril back through the grand hall and past a surprising find, a very modern little bathroom. All crafted from light wood, copper, and white marble, the bathroom had some obvious design differences from those Saffron was used to, but it was identifiable for what it was, and she turned to a smiling Cyril.
"Is this
indoor plumbing?"
"Yes."
He seemed pleased.
"King Kalakaua developed all kinds of niceties for palace living. He had indoor plumbing, a telephone, and electricity all before the White House did."
Saffron blinked. She had not known that.
"He even had an ice maker," Cyril said. "If you dined at the palace, ice cream was one of the dessert choices."
"That sounds like fun," Saffron said.
On a sweltering day like this, ice cream sounded divine. And of all people, Saffron loved a good party. She felt a kinship with the king as Cyril detailed his carefully planned parties.
"By all accounts, it was," Cyril agreed. "He was called the Merry Monarch."
The elegance of the palace continued into the next area, an elegant dining room and what their guide called the Blue Room. It was a comfortable little sitting room. A wide doorway with sliding pocket doors led back into the dining room, and several opulent blue chairs lined the walls. A thick carpet covered the floor, and an elegant koa wood piano stood in one corner. Above it hung a large portrait.
"King David Kalakaua," Cyril said. "The monarch whose vision built this palace."
He was a stately man. His royal uniform sported a blue sash and a solid block of medals. His eyes, she thought, were kind. Behind him in the painting sat the scepter and crown Saffron had seen in the throne room.
and he wore a terrific set of mutton chops which added to the sense of another moment in history.
Saffron looked at the other pictures.
Next to the first was King Kalakaua's wife, Queen Kapi'olani. There were also paintings that were gifts from other monarchs. One, a huge painting of a French king given as a gift to the royal family, which Cyril said was so big that it took 12 men to carry it from the wharf to the palace when it arrived, took up one whole corner. Saffron stood entranced in front of a portrait of the exquisite Queen Liliuokalani, the king's sister, who, Saffron learned, ascended the throne after him. The painting showed the queen in a striking black gown with a blue sash. Ornate jewelry drew Saffron's eye. A silver butterfly comb in the queen's hair. Brooches shaped like flowers and crosses. What struck her most, though, was the queen's beauty and the strength evident in her stance and her expression. Saffron sensed Cyril at her elbow. Without taking her eyes from the painting, she breathed, "What a powerful woman." Cyril hummed his agreement.
"Just wait until you get upstairs," he said, "and see what strength she had."
The statement seemed rather cryptic to Saffron, and there was an undercurrent of sadness in Cyril's voice that cast a frosty pallor over the comfortable room. Bertie clucked from the other end of the room. Saffron held her questions as they made their way through the dining room, where Saffron stopped a moment to admire the play settings. Everything was elegant and refined. She peered at the perfectly polished silverware. At the base of each utensil was a monogram. Two K's, one backward and one forward, facing each other, with what looked like a smaller eye in the middle. Above the letters hovered a crown like she'd seen in the throne room.
"Kalakaua's monogram," Cyril said over her shoulder.
Saffron imagined herself seated at the beautifully set table with the regal Hawaiian royal family, and a little shiver went up her spine. She'd rarely seen such an impressive place. On the second floor, Saffron marveled at the beautiful upholstery, the decadent carved bedroom sets, and the opulence. There were bedrooms, each with its own bathroom, and a library. There was an office, where the king performed his daily work of running the kingdom of Hawaii. Saffron wandered around the office. Decorated in rich reds, it had a formal feel. Everything looked pristine, as if King Kalakaua had only just stepped out of the room and would return any moment to pick up his pen and continue the correspondence on his desk. Saffron peered at the paper. A letter on paper graced with the same monogram she'd seen on the silver downstairs. Two K's surrounding an eye, topped by a crown. The far end of the room had a temporary exhibit set up. Several easels holding grainy black and white enlarged photos. The photos showed the room as it had been at the time of Kalakaua's reign, and Saffron could see that little had changed. Saffron peered at the photos, switching her gaze from the photos to the actual scene before her quickly, as if playing the old game where you had to spot the differences between two images. "Everything is just like it was then," she said. Cyril grunted.
"We're certainly trying," he said. "But the palace had a difficult period, and a lot of things were lost."
"Difficult period?"
He confirmed. "Just before the turn of the century, the Hawaiian monarchy was coerced into relinquishing its power. It was overthrown, and the palace was emptied out and used to house the government offices. A lot of decorations, furniture, and art was sold at a public auction. Some were given away, and some were stolen outright. We've been working for decades to retrieve it or recreate it and restore the palace."
Saffron looked around in awe. Without Cyril's explanation, she would not have known that these beautiful artifacts had been removed from their home. But as she looked closer, she saw subtle differences between the pictures and the room in which she was standing. She began to distinguish details in the photos and spotted anomalies. For example, on the wall facing the massive Gothic Revival desk in the center of the rectangular room, the historic black and white photo showed two dark brackets. Peering closely at the photo, Saffron could see a small statue atop each bracket. When she looked at the wall in front of her now, there were neither brackets nor statues.
she commented on it to Cyril.
Yes, those were called spelter statues, he said. Sort of a knockoff bronze that was popular back then. We're still searching for them. They're on our most wanted list.
Do people still find some of these things?
Sure. People have rescued them from garbage dumps, thrift shops, their grandmother's attics, you name it. They've been discovered as far away as Italy, and as near as a few blocks away.
Cyril sighed.
We've had a lot of help from people wanting to see that things are returned to where they belong. Our searchers become very passionate about the project.
I can see why, Saffron said. It's like a giant worldwide treasure hunt. Plus, you get the satisfaction of helping to right an old wrong.
Cyril smiled his approval of her assessment.
Cyril,
Bertie chirped from across the room.
When they looked up, she motioned him over. Cyril smiled an apology at Saffron and went to talk to the woman.
Saffron moved from photo to photo, now spotting the missing pieces with a new eye. Here was a missing vase, there an absent bookend. One artifact in particular caught her eye. A striking inkwell atop a wooden writing slope that sat on an ornately carved side table. She peered closer. The inkwell was exquisite. A round, beautiful hen in just the same shade of light gray as Luna, laying in a nest. The inkwell had a cover across the chicken's back that flipped open to reveal a smooth glass egg inside. Laying on its side and brimming with silky ink. The hen's tail feathers were finely detailed, and one of them was a removable silver dip pen. Saffron peered closer. It was a gorgeous piece. In addition to the egg farm, her uncle had left her 2 generations worth of chicken decor. Cast chickens, ceramic chickens, carved chickens. The collection included objects with practical uses, like the chicken-covered dish set, or the salt and pepper shakers, or the chicken boot scraper. It also included purely decorative statuary and paintings. Sorting and arranging the collection in her beachside bungalow had given her an eye for chicken decor. And this piece was spectacular. How about this one? She asked Cyril, pointing to the photo.
The chicken inkwell, he said, knowing to what she was referring even before he crossed the room to her. A remarkable piece. It has yet to be located.
Saffron felt a pang of disappointment. She would have liked to see it. Saffron tore her gaze away from it and looked at her watch. She should have just enough time to finish up the tour before she had to be back to double-check the caterer's tables. Crossing the upper hall, Saffron followed Cyril and Bertie into a very different kind of room. Here, the light from the windows was tempered by darkened glass. The room was bare except for a large glass case in the center with a bright and colorful quilt. There was a somber tone in the room, and when Saffron looked closer at the quilt, she saw why. Embroidered onto one block in beautiful stitched script, she read, "Imprisoned at Iolani Palace." Saffron read on, the dates and names of Queen Liliuokalani Kalani and her companions. "We began this quilt there," it read.
"Imprisoned?" Saffron asked. "Here?"
She understood now why Cyril's voice had been solemn and why he'd mentioned the queen's strength. Cyril nodded, his wide forehead smoothing as his eyebrows drew downward, and Bertie bobbed her head.
"When a group of loyalists tried to restore the monarchy of Hawaii, she was charged with treason and imprisoned in this room for 8 months. She was allowed to have a companion, but no visitors."
Saffron felt that chill again. She remembered vividly the power of the woman in the portrait downstairs and tried to imagine her being forced to stay in this room for months on end. Saffron took in the subtle shades of the quilt. It was a complexity of shapes and colors, all pieced together with various stitches. Saffron knew what it was like for your life to shatter. When her father had left, when her mother had died, she'd felt the jagged shards of her life in her hands. She could see the same chaos in the queen's quilt. yet here and there she also saw patches of clarity. An owl or pueo embroidered here, a cherry branch there, an exquisite fish, and a key. Seeing the key, such a clear symbol of the queen's wish for freedom, broke Saffron's heart. Miss Skye? Saffron's attention was diverted from the quilt by someone speaking her name. She turned to see one of the members of the palace staff. Your caterers are ready. Saffron gave the girl a nod. I'll get out there. She turned to Cyril. I've learned so many new things today, she said, hoping that her gratitude was conveyed in her tone.
That's our hope here at the palace, to improve the depth of your understanding about Hawaiian history and culture.
Her visit had certainly done that.
Chapter 3.
The enormous donation jar was filling up with black and gold plastic Easter eggs into which guests had tucked cash and checks. Saffron watched a moment as one of Honolulu's real estate moguls, Julius Tay, made a big show of pulling a huge wad of bills from his pocket and tucking them into egg after egg. Tay, a large square man with an even larger voice, wore a tidy blue suit, the exact color, Saffron noticed, of ripe blueberries, with a burgundy silk handkerchief in the pocket. Octavia Morris, whose tour company showed hundreds of thousands of people around the islands every year, was not to be outdone. She stepped up and flashed cash too, raking a pile of eggs toward her and filling them with a flourish before jauntily shooting them like little basketballs into the jar. Several more people crowded around, and Saffron saw two of the waiters step up to stabilize the big jar. There was a brief frenzy of giving. Saffron smiled at the friendly competition and at the success of her scheme. Tay's big voice boomed out across the party. His childhood in Singapore was evident in his pronunciation, but so too were years of practiced enunciation. The result was a crisp, easy style of speech that by its distinctiveness made people stop and listen. His words were directed at a small man sitting at a table with his back to the donation jar.
Hey, Flint, come on and crack open that wallet. It hasn't seen daylight since the Reagan administration.
The little man turned, slowly and stiffly. His voice was creaky, as if he didn't use it much.
I'm not here to buy chicken feed. I'm here 'cause my wife made me come and I'm sitting right here until she tells me I can go.
Saffron scanned her memory. This must be Marv Flint, the most wealthy of the invited guests.
Don't you care about making Hawaii a better place? Octavia teased. Surely you could do with fewer roosters waking you up in the morning.
I'm up before the roosters, Flint snapped back. And my wife has already put enough of my money into that monstrous eyesore.
Saffron felt a pang. She thought the donation jar was very pretty with the light shining off the golden eggs and the blown glass encompassing it all. But Flint didn't seem to have much of an eye for style. He looked more like an 1890s prospector than a multimillionaire. He wore a pair of faded slacks and scuffed loafers, and under his scraggly white beard was a grayed polo shirt.
I bet I've got you beat,
Tay called, tossing his own eggs into the jar.
How much has she put in here?
Flint tossed his reply over his shoulder nonchalantly, but Saffron's perfect eye for color detected the flush of red around his ears and cheeks, the hallmarks of rising anger.
Too much. He rose just as Tay strode toward him. But don't you worry. I'm gonna get it back.
Don't you dare go robbing this nest, Octavia scolded. This is for...
Flint slammed a hand on the table.
This is for the birds, he shouted.
And Saffron could see that he wasn't talking about chickens, as he spun and stalked away through the tables. He left an awkward silence in his wake. The remaining donors at the table slipped their eggs into the jar with little boasting, and Tay and Octavia wandered away toward the stage. It only took seconds for the festive atmosphere to return, though. The chickens were clucking pleasantly, and the live band sent music trickling out through the posh crowd. Half an hour before people would start fading away, leaving the party to go on with their various lives. Then Saffron could oversee cleanup, load her birds, and go home. A waiter passed with a tray of hors d'oeuvre. Saffron reached for the creation she had developed with the caterers. When she'd first met with them, they'd recommended one of their best-loved creations, bite-sized chicken with mango glaze placed on a crunchy seaweed strip atop a chewy toast square. But Saffron had insisted on a different menu. "I'm not serving chicken to the Friends of Hens," she'd argued. Instead, she'd spent all one night crafting a party-specific menu, bite-sized honey seed cakes for a sweet touch, and for a savory choice, crisp whole-grain discs topped with corn and avocado salsa. She let the caterers work their magic, and now as she popped a disc into her mouth, she knew the risk had paid off. The food fit the theme and was another subtle detail that pulled the party together. Saffron looked around with satisfaction. This was her 7th event in Hawaii, if she counted the open house she'd had at her bungalow when she first came, and she was finally feeling more confident about her connections and her understanding of her clients. The palace sat regally in the background. Birdie chatted with a donor over by the 3-foot chicken ice sculpture, and the smell of plumeria hung in the air. The evening had grown dark, and the glow of the lights strung overhead gave the party an intimate feel. Minot chatted amicably with some guests. Saffron was glad she'd brought him along. Not only had he been a big help with the chickens, but their conversation on the way down from Maikai had made the drive fly by. She was, if she admitted it, a little worried about the old man. He was tough, that was certain. But since Keahi had gone, she noticed in Minot a weariness that she hadn't seen before.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.